We have entered a new year, and probably there's not one of us who is unhappy about leaving 2020 behind. I think we're all happy to leave 2020 behind, and we're happy to at least be entering 2021. Now, 2020 will always be remembered historically as the year of a global pandemic that affected the lives of millions of Americans, the death toll here now in the hundreds of thousands, a toll that keeps rising, and as I mentioned a moment ago, is worse now in LA and Orange counties than it's ever been before. We have grieving families, but also the isolation of lockdowns and its accompanying loneliness and depression. The toll, to put it mildly, has been staggering. But with the arrival of vaccines and the beginning of vaccinations nationwide, some light has at least begun to appear at the end of the COVID-19 tunnel. Already, some of our St. Paul's Parish family working in hospitals, doctors and nurses, have received the initial round of the vaccine, and with no real side effects other than maybe a sore arm for a few hours, just as if you were getting your flu shot. It's a hopeful sign. People sometimes say to me that we will never go back to normal. I don't believe that. I have to be very blunt. I don't believe that. From 1918 to 1920, years that coincided with World War I, there was a deadly flu epidemic that here in the U.S. alone killed 650,000 people. That's more people than we lost in World War I, World War II, and the Korean War, and the Vietnam War combined. At a time when we didn't even know what a virus is, and antibiotics had yet to be invented. Things did go back to normal. In fact, so normal that most of us didn't even know about the flu pandemic of 1918 until this year, when doctors and historians began looking back to see what could be learned from the 20th century that might help us in dealing with our pandemic now in the 21st century. Now, there are things each year that we're supposed to take away, that we're supposed to learn. And I think we can say that we at least learned a few things, these things at the very least. Number one, the world can change very quickly. Number two, prayer is an indispensable anchor in difficult times. Number three, faith matters. Hope matters. Number four, I think we discovered how much we need each other, and that the kindness of others is a great gift that we should never take for granted. I think we learned to be grateful for our families, and I'm hoping also that all of us learn to be grateful for St. Paul's as a community. But as you know, our 24/7 news cycle keeps us tense and on the alert, filling the media we consume with negative stories, endless speculations, and foolish and untrue conspiracy theories. We are kept anxious and fearful. Riots and violence, political uncertainty, division, hatred. Even in the last century, in the 50s and 60s, when people got their news almost entirely from newspapers and a one-half-hour evening news show, the common journalistic slogan was, if it bleeds, it leads. Now today, with our 24/7 news cycle, that's been magnified 1,000 times over. I said a moment ago, the media we consume. I probably should have said, the media that consumes us. All news today seems to be bad news, and it captures our attention. Now, I almost never, as you know, recommend TV programs and documentaries, but I had the opportunity to watch a program twice this past week. It's called The Social Dilemma, and it's been recommended to me by a very wise person, so I made sure to watch it twice. It's well worth your taking the time to watch as well, if you've not done so already. It looks at the negative effects that a handful of companies like Google, like Facebook, like Instagram and Twitter, have on our personal and public life, all to maximize profit from advertisements. I won't tell you about this program in great detail. I think it's important that you actually watch it for yourselves. It's available on Netflix, but if you don't have Netflix, it's available on Vimeo. And in fact, I'm going to see if Facebook will allow me to post it on our Facebook page, just to be sure that you can watch it if you can. I'm not going to go much further, but I do want to mention just a few things about this program, things that I learned really for the first time. Obviously, while social media platforms can be beneficial, connecting us to family members and friends across long distances, across continents even, sharing important knowledge, and even helping to find organ donors. And you know, of course, that we at St. Paul's, we have our Facebook page and our Instagram page because I want to share the gospel with as many people as possible. But nonetheless, social media is used in many, many negative ways. For example, one of the things that this program points out, that false information on Twitter spreads 6 times faster than true information because people have a greater emotional reaction towards fake news, what's not true. So what does that mean for us on a practical level? Well, let me use St. Paul's as an example. What that means is anything that I post about the Lord Jesus saying something like, love your neighbor as yourself, will spread 6 times more slowly than if I say something like President Trump, President-elect Biden, and let me just throw in the Kardashians, are really aliens from another planet sent here to begin Armageddon. That will travel 6 times faster than anything I say about loving your neighbor as yourself. Can you believe that? But it is true. And did you know that artificial intelligence algorithms built into the systems used by social media companies are actually biased towards spreading that false information? Why? Because we as human beings show interest in such articles. It piques our emotions at a gut level. It's recommended to more people then by the algorithm itself, by a non-thinking machine. So good news spreads slowly, bad news spreads rapidly. So if you can think about this, not only bad news, artificial intelligence actually spreads false information much faster and much further than anything that's true. So I want to stop there and just simply recommend that you watch the program for yourself. Now, you may be thinking to yourself at home, what's a Christian supposed to do about all this? Well, the first thing to remember is that Christians are always supposed to be part of the solution and never a part of the problem. And this always requires, on our part, repentance, mercy, and compassion. So if the news that we receive is mostly bad news, we have to remember that we as Christians have the good news. This morning, if you listen carefully to the gospel reading that Deacon Dan read, we hear the very first gospel of the new year, beginning with these words. It's from the Gospel of Mark. It's the very first chapter, the very first verse. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It's interesting that this is the way that Mark the evangelist chose to start his story about Jesus. Christianity is the beginning of good news, and the good news of Jesus gives us a new vision, a real vision grounded in the truth, a vision of life and a vision for living. So we're all about the gospel, to evangelion, we would say in Greek, the good news in this life. And we know that our Lord Jesus Christ endured suffering. We know that death is not the end, but the door through which we step into eternal life. We're about the good news that the real God, the God of Jesus, is the God of love and not a God of hate, Not a God that compels some men to ram airplanes into Twin Towers in New York. We're about the good news that even in 2020, we are still digging wells in Tanzania so that people we will never meet, more than half a world away, will have fresh water to drink for the first time. We're about the good news that the Lord Jesus is the truth. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And therefore, because he is the truth, we as his covenanted people, as his people, we will only speak the truth in love, as the Apostle Paul wrote. We will never add to the lies, to the falsehoods, to the propaganda, to the hatred that others spread on social media and other kinds of communication platforms. Being children of the truth means that we will spread no lies, no propaganda, no hatred. And when we must confront lies, falsehood, and hatred, as Christians, we will always do so in a loving manner, as St. Paul says. So as we enter 2021, we need to remember that as Christians, as men and women who are slaves of Jesus Christ, slaves of Jesus Christ, it is his will that we pray, we do every time we pray the Lord's Prayer, thy will be done. Because we are his slaves, we will proclaim this good news of Jesus boldly, fearlessly, sharing our hope, sharing our faith, sharing our love, no matter how many people are spreading the bad news and the lies of this world. We have the good news of eternity. Now, after St. Mark proclaims the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, he then goes on to outline some of St. John the Baptist's ministry. And the emphasis there is on repentance. Repentance means that we turn back to God. Repentance means looking at the direction of our lives and realizing that we are all too often led by the world's values, that we're too often led by the world around us and are therefore going in the wrong direction. As all of us begin the new year, we have choices to make and a path to choose. We look up to Jesus Christ, never down, never to the right, never to the left. We always look up and we draw our life from him and his kingdom. So as we begin 2021, let me mention to you just these things. We need to renew and be defined by the good news of Jesus. We need to take less and we need to give more. We need to be faithful in little things. We need to focus more on light than we do on darkness. We need to talk less. Certainly, I need to talk less. But say more. Say what is most meaningful. Otherwise, keep your mouth shut. I need to hear myself say that to me every day. In fact, I'm thinking for 2021, I'm going to put a sign on the mirror when I get up in the morning and I have to go into the bathroom and look at that sign. Talk less, dummy, but say more. We have to think of ourselves less and think of other people more. We have to be simple. We have to cultivate gratitude for everything. If we can be strict with ourselves, okay. But we are to be merciful and compassionate with everybody else. May God bless, guide, guard, and protect us in this new year.